Sure.
So tell us, we've got a few things here that were great stories on EcoRI this week. A lot going on with the CRMC, the Coastal Resources Management Council, the board shakeup. What's the chatter in the environmental community?
Well, the chatter is, it doesn't seem to be a coincidence that the three people with the most vocal about environmental protections were booted off, or at least three out of top three people that cared about the environmental protections. Not that the other people didn't care, but the people that spoke up the most were booted, and three new people, brought on. I don't know if
We don't know enough about the
they
new
could be
ones
cap
yet.
you know they could be all be Captain Earths and stuff. I have no idea, but it was interesting that the governor decided to boot off people that were environmentally conscious.
Was there a lot of chatter about that? I mean, you wrote the article, but I mean, you're in the community. Was it sort of what's going on here?
There was some chatter, there were some emails, there were some Facebook comments and Twitter comments that, what's going on, typical this, typical that. And it's a little alarming, but we'll get to pause and see what the new people do and stuff. But one of the people that was kicked off, if you will, is one term for 2 years. Now they reappointed another person who's been on there for 20 years. And I'm not saying that other person or whoever's good and bad and all that, I'm not saying that, but it just.
So, an inherently political body, if you will, by
Yeah.
lieu of being appointed by the governor. But talk with us, you're in that world, you know the CRMC. How much power do they have in making environmental decisions in the state?
The staff or the board?
Well, both. Let's talk
Well,
about the sort of breakdown and sort of the power structure that has raised eyebrows to say, oh, wait a minute, these were sort of our three champions. Why was that important?
because the board is ultimately the boss of the staff for CRMC, so they do a great job. Everybody knows Grover. Grover's well known. Fugate, who's the ED, nationally recognized for his work in climate change. And Jim Boyd, they have, a staff of good people. Ultimately, they have to abide by what the board decides. And the board has decided, like a seawall at Ocean Mist,
That's been quite a controversial story.
My point being, not to get into that, go down that rabbit hole, but CRMC's policy is no hard structure, but the board made an exception for this. So it should be more like Save the Bay and Topher Hamlin have mentioned that it should be more like DEM, where there's DEM people. It's not a board, it's people, staffers
Yeah.
ahead of it that make the decisions, rather than a board that's appointed by the governor.
Do you think we'll ever see a change in the kind of that structure with kind of increased rumblings, if you will?
I think eventually maybe. I mean, it went from really political and it's changed a little bit. So yeah, I think eventually over time, I don't know what time, could be 10 years, 20 years, I don't know, but I think eventually.
What was it? Could elected officials serve on it? Did I see that in the
That used to be, yeah,
article?
that was one, exactly, basically.
That's only just a little political.
Exactly, so they got rid of that. It took a lot of effort back in the 90s and early 2000s, so it took a lot of effort to do that. So it's gonna take a lot of effort to, this governor-appointed people are just gonna do what the governor wants. Not all the time, and I'm not saying every decision the CRMC board has done has been a mistake. I'm not saying that, but when you have that conflict of interest, if you will, it's gonna be problems.
Well, we're going to keep an eye on it. EcoRI had written about the kind of shakeup on the board structure. Governor appointing, not reappointing some
And they were champion
existing.
appointees,
They
so
were
that's probably
champion,
part of it
to the
too.
victor go the spoils, but in the environmental community, the eyebrows are raised because they were the real stalwart environmental
Yeah, they
champions.
were the three the most outspoken, and
We'll see what
they're,
the new ones do.
yeah,
Okay,
exactly.
and we'll read about it in
Exactly. They might be
EcoRI.
wonderful. Who knows?
We'll check that out. But let's go through another story that I want to pick your brain a little bit about here. The South Kingston Land Trust this week, again, got the addition of 22 acres of land down there. Talk to us about the roles of land trusts in the state. We've talked about, as you always continuously mention, sort of the lack of overarching policy in terms of land preservation. But you see a headline like that. How big is it that the South Kingston Land Trust was able to get 22 acres secured?
It's big. They also got 12 more around, I don't name the pond down there, because the Y, Yahoo Pond or something. I don't, it's not Yahoo Pond, but anyway, they protected land around the pond too. So that's 22 and 12 is what, 44? So, no, I'm terrible. Okay,
34.
34, yeah, close. Whatever. Anyway,
I'm not good at numbers, it's fine.
34 acres of preserved land. That's why I'm an English major, not a mathematician. But it's important, but land trusts can't be counted on to protect all the land, and it's a lot of work. It's expensive. It's a ton of work. Most of the staffs and land trusts are volunteers.
Yeah.
Nobody's getting paid to do all this hard work. So yeah, that's great that they did that, of course, and it's great that this town does that and that land trust does this. But then collectively, when we have these bigger projects, we just can't. Oh, that they saved that space, so now we'll just cut, 60 acres here or whatever. It doesn't make up for it. So it's hard, but
how many land trusts are there, though? I don't want to say there's every.
There's 47, I believe.
Okay.
And then that includes the Rhode Island Land Trust Council, which kind of, not oversees, but he kind of oversees the umbrella for all of them.
But as you said, they can't be the ones doing the heavy lifting.
No, they can't. They don't necessarily have the funding. They don't have paid staff, or very few do. And the paid staff, it is probably part-time, and it's probably not good money. So it's a lot of hard work.
Well, we saw that, and I just wanted to ask kind of the importance of it and the relevance of it. And as I said, wanted to pick your brain on land trusts. And speaking of land preservation, let's see if I can get this specifically. There's some grant money available at the state level to protect open space?
Yeah, DEM has $4 million, I believe.
Okay.
That's available. I think the deadline to submit an application or press report, October, yep.
Yeah.
So if you have a municipality or a nonprofit or an NGO or something and you want some land to protect, they have some money for it, which
so
is
who,
great too.
Yeah,
I mean,
who,
but that's.
But again, it's not the be all and end all.
No, it's not going to, like, you save a patch here, you save a patch here, but you keep fragmenting them, it doesn't really matter. That's the big problem. But it is money available. They are trying, you know, get people to save some special open space. It helps.
Speaking of open space, what's the brouhaha over the Rick parking lot?
They want to make more parking there. They, from what you gather from, I forgot the name of the rep from North Providence who was concerned about it, as others should be, they just kind of went ahead with this project kind of without talking to the proper people or having the proper permits, and it's already a flooding problem in that neighborhood, partly part of what Rick has done with parking before. So just expand parking, you can have more stormwater, you can have more flooding.
Do you think we'll see do you think Rick will just steamroll through the opposition and say we just need more parking and just sort of barrel on through? Or do you think that folks with environmental concerns will be able to have an impact?
That's a good question. I don't know if Rick steamrolls as well as others, so I don't know, but it's possible.
Who's the best steamroller in Rhode Island?
Oh, that's a good question.
You can put a list together, and then we'll
talk
about it.
The governor? I don't know who the best steamroller would be. Invenergy, I guess? They're not in Rhode Island, but they're trying to do something in Rhode Island.
Just pushing things through. Well, I was curious to see about that. I think that we'll probably hear a little bit more about that moving forward. We'll see you next week. Anything else you want to share with folks in the meantime?
No, I'm not sure where I'm not sure what's coming up because I'm not sure where Tim is. So
Tim Faulkner, MIA. Where are you, Tim?
Well,
is this sort of like where's Waldo?
Hey, he needs a break from the state house. Yeah, where's Waldo? Exactly. Could be anywhere.
If you see Tim Faulkner, let us know because he's got deadlines to meet.
No, he doesn't. He needs the break. I just know where he is and what he's doing.
Well, it is high summertime. We hope that everyone has a great weekend. As always, appreciate your coming in to talk about the great big stories on EcoRI.
Absolutely.
We look forward to having you in next week, whether it's you or Joanna or Tim if we find him.
It could be Tim if we find him. Bring him back from the brink.
Frank
thank
Carini,
you.
Give me a hot cup.
Thank you.
Okay, I'll let you go. Frank Carini, editor at EcoRI, comes in every Friday to Go Local to talk about the biggest stories on EcoRI.org. We talked a little bit about the shakeup at the Coastal Resources Management Council, the CRMC, the quite powerful body deciding on issues on the coastline. Talked a little bit about that, as well as some land trust land acquisition, as Frank always likes to talk about the land planning policy or lack thereof at the state level, but keeps an eye on who's preserving land where, and just mentioned that there's again some state money available for folks looking to apply for that. That's on EcoRI as well, so be sure